O'Harold presents. Internationally acclaimed music appreciationist O'Harold and his Barra Disco program. The term Barra Disco has been coined by O'Harold to combine the words Baroque and Disco, which cover the golden age of music from March 5, 1575 to August 17, 1983, give or take a few weeks. Mr. O'Harold offers the liveliest and finest program on radio today and always features only the best music. So even though some critics do not agree with him personally and wish he would die, they must admire his impeccable taste and knowledge about music. These programs have been gracing the airwaves coast to coast and in Canada for 20 years and depend on your support of the Barra Disco Society. Thus, your letters and donations to O'Harold will encourage him and this station to continue bringing you this superb program. Now, here is the incomparable O'Harold.
Thank you. My first work is a beautiful little tune by Jacques Offenbach, a baricole from the Tales of Hoffmann. It is performed by Maestro Mantrovani, conducting his 101 strings. Now I'd like to tell you the names of each and every one of those 101 musicians, because heaven knows they deserve the recognition for bringing us this super OTU music. But as usual, I must stop talking so I can bring you as much of your favorite Barra Disco music as possible. Wasn't that just lovely? It was so beautiful and flowing. It just makes you want to fall asleep. But wait, we have something just as beautiful coming up. Franz Schubert was the first composer to feature the clarinet in a sonata, which he wrote in 1673. Before this time, the clarinet was considered too shrill and irritating to play serious music, and so was little used, except for comic or grotesque effects. We now hear Schubert's second clarinet sonata in G major, written the following year. This sonata in two movements, Molto non troppo and Poco fermata, is performed by Pierre Spilaro on clarinet with the Cleveland Chamber Orchestra, Stan Levine conductor. Second movement of this sonata, Schubert uses a small chorus to further contrast between the beauty of the accompaniment and the harsh screeches of the clarinet, or Pfeifel as it was called in that day. As always in Schubert's choral works, the text is of a religious nature. You may sing along if you wish.
Thank you.
Wasn't that a lovely version of Schubert's second clarinet sonata? You know it. However, I get rather angry listening to virtuoso clarinet performances like this one, because I know if I had practiced as a lad, I would be every bit as good. But alas, like all geniuses, I spent my spare time watching TV. Our next piece features the instrument now universally considered King of the Woodwinds. That's right, the saxophone. But things were different during the early baradisco period. The saxophone was heard even less than the lowly clarinet. On this rare RCA recording, the greatest hits for Baroque saxophone, you may be surprised, as I was, to find that Beethoven wrote for the saxophone. In fact, on the day he died, he rewrote the first movement of his famous Fifth Symphony to include alto sax. We now hear this revised version performed by Isaac Stern, saxophonist, with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, René Liebowitz, conductor. That was the revised first movement of Symphony No. 5 by Beethoven. Or is it Beethoven? Alas, I am too poverty-stricken to buy a pronunciation guide. What little money does come in all goes to put food in the mouths of my poor, hungry family and pay the wages of our meager staff of servants. So when you write, I'm sure you'll be generous and help out in any way you can. Next, we have an Argo recording of Vivaldi's Du Sol's Tanzenschein, performed by the Gibb Chorale. Robin and Maurice Gibb, altos. Barry and Andy Gibb, castrato sopranos. With the Academy of St. Martin in the Fields, Neville Mariner, conductor.
Keep it warm.
wasn't that just super OSU? Vivaldi's Du Sol's Tonsenschein, a wonderful bit of choral heaven. Next, we have an example of what I consider good music at an affordable price. I found this USR release in the bottom of the bargain bin at Kmart for only $1.25. Now, I think $2 is the maximum price anyone ought to pay for an album. Musicians make almost nothing by cutting a record. It's the bandit baron record companies that reap in the profits on $6, $7, and $8 albums, which cost them next to nothing to make. So I suggest we all join in a protest and destroy every record we have ever purchased for over $2. But back to the next selection. This is a familiar light classical piece I'm sure you will recognize, performed by an orchestra and conductor who, for unexplained reasons, wished to remain anonymous. Any conductor to direct a performance of such great beauty should be proud to have his name on the album cover. It sounded a bit like Leonard Bernstein conducting the New York Philharmonic, didn't it? What do you think? Going on to our next section, we hear a medley of short songs written during the 16th century by Claude Debussy. The individual songs all have Frenchy names, so I won't bother reading them since few of you are fluently multilingual as I am. We hear this authentic performance on original instruments by the Royal Scots Symphony Orchestra, Jacob Pride, conductor.